Everybody likes mini golf, right? Today, I'm officially launching my second free and open source microgame, a mini golf game that you can download the full project on GitHub and play the full free game on itch. In this video, we're gonna go over the high level design and the tools that you need to make your own mini golf game. And over the coming weeks and months, I'm gonna cover all of the different aspects that went into making this microgame. Hey, Chris here from LlamAcademy, here to help you.
Ooh, me?
Yes, you. Make your game dev dream become reality by giving you full projects that you can use as reference material to make your own games. First, let's talk about the game design. Well, most people are familiar with mini golf, right? You have different terrain to go over, like grass or sand. Maybe you have to jump over water or something of that nature. Usually there's some kind of obstacles. We'll talk a little bit more about those in a little bit. But the core concept here is you have a ball, you aim the ball, you shoot it with different power, and you try to get in a hole with some number of putts. Pretty straightforward. Unity physics handles the vast majority of things for us. It's just a matter of configuring that. And then the interaction paradigm with the world is also pretty straightforward. Now, I targeted mobile on this game. So we have tap to the ball and then drag to increase the power and tap anywhere else just to rotate the camera. So if you're targeting something like desktop or console, then you'll probably have a little bit different UI and a different interaction paradigm, but conceptually the gameplay is still the same. And I think that makes this an excellent choice for newcomers into game development because there's not that many weird things you need to know about. You don't have to know about AI or any of that stuff. It's really just put the ball and then come up with cool obstacles to make the game harder, which actually brings us into the second component of the game, and that's the level design. And mini golf games, at least if they're gonna be successful on mobile, I don't know that much about desktop and console versions of mini golf, but on mobile, you need lots of levels. I played several mini golf games on my phone on airplanes because they're easy to play without internet, and there's hundreds of levels, hundreds. So if you want to be competitive, you're going to need to be able to quickly create new levels that are interesting as well. And what I did in this game was for the simple layouts where we don't have like multi-levels and like you do a spiral or something like that, where it's just simple basic level structure, using the 2D tile map tools are actually extremely beneficial and make it really easy to put together levels quickly. I only used maybe 7 or 8 tiles to make the entire game. Well, I made a couple extra just to make it go a little bit faster, but conceptually, there's only 7 or 8 tiles that I used for the 10 different holes that I made. And some of those were convenience. So you can get by and make quite a large variety of levels with very few tiles. And each of the levels here, the 10 holes I made, took minutes. Like I'm talking 2, 3, 4 minutes to make once I set up the tile map properly. And if you're not a 3D modeler, no problem. I used ProBuilder, which is a free extension of Unity, to create these tiles and prototype different tiles for me to play around with. Of course, you don't have to use ProBuilder if you're like a Blender guru, which I am definitely not. I'm a total noob. You can use any 3D modeling program to make these tiles. And then it's just assigning grid tiles. Here's how that level is going to be set up. And the best part about this is you don't have to know all the tiles up front. You can start with 2, 3 tiles, grass, wall, hole. Start with that. And then as you come up with new ideas and you want to implement more complex things, you can just add in new tiles later into your later levels. And that's exactly how obstacles work. They're just a new tile that have some kind of obstacle like a windmill on that tile. So you can make as complex or as simple obstacles as you want and just make a new tile with that obstacle. If you made it this far into the video and you're still interested, go ahead and leave me a like, subscribe to the channel. That way you can be notified whenever all of these videos come out where we break down each mechanic, each aspect of what we're talking about today independently. It really helps me a lot. And I'm sure it's gonna help you a lot as well. Once we have that tool to be able to create the levels, well, we need to actually make those levels. I actually only have 2 scenes in this whole game with the 10 different holes. I've got the main menu scene. It's just the menu, a background, kind of looks nice. And the game scene that I wanted to do this with just one scene. So all of the levels look the same. The additive scene loading workflow, just for me, it leaves a lot of room for error where you can accidentally add in a light or forget about a light and it changes how the scene looks. So what I wanted to do was create the levels in the game scene, save that layout of that scene to a scriptable object along with the par. So how many putts they should get like 3 stars, 2 stars, 1 star and fail. Then at runtime, we'll dynamically build out that level based on what we saved in the scriptable object, which just houses the position, rotation, scale, and then the prefab that we're gonna spawn at that location. So I made an editor tool that helps me load these and preview exactly what the game's gonna do to make sure everything's working okay. We can save that to the scriptable object, configure the par, and then just clear out the scene and start making the next one. This allowed me to really quickly prototype those levels, try them out even, just click play, try it out right there, make sure everything's good, everything looks good, great, go ahead and clear it, move on to the next level. Now there's one really important thing that was extremely unexpected for me as I was making this game. I thought the Unity physics were just gonna be no problem, everything works. That was not the case, turns out. There's a lot of problems. Well, there's really one problem with what's happening here. Because we have multiple different objects that are right next to each other, even though they're perfectly aligned, as the ball is rolling forward and it detects that it's coming up to the next collider, sometimes it will inaccurately predict, regardless of the collision detection mode that you set the rigid body to have, that, hey, this is an edge that I should hit. And then the ball just bounce off and it looks really stupid because you have a totally flat plane. At least it appears to be a totally flat plane and your ball just goes flying. So we're not gonna get in this video into all the physics stuff, but I know that's gonna be a really exciting one to check out whenever that comes out. That was a totally unexpected thing for me. I spent way more time than I was going to have to. Actually, probably the majority of the time I spent working on this microgame was messing with the physics to make it where that didn't happen anymore. And I'm gonna share with you how you can do that as well. And we of course have the user interface. The UI is pretty much out of the way, but it does have important aspects that I'd like to cover. Importantly, there are some reusable components, and I'm going to show you some of the best practices of making UI toolkit components and using them on different menus or different UI documents. Some of these examples are straight from Unity. They have the Dragon Crashers asset tutorial exploratory thing on the asset store. So we'll walk through how you can do some of those things and how I did them in this Minigolf microgame as well. This helps you keep your UI organized with UI toolkit, which then allows you to focus on the actual gameplay and not how do I do this thing with the UI and why do I have this spaghetti monster UI manager class. I've got to say, I've learned a lot more than I thought I was going to making this Minigolf microgame, and I'm really excited to share with you all the lessons that I learned throughout this process, especially around the ball physics and how we combine the level at the end to help smooth out the bumps. Really were eye-opening experiences for me. If you got value out of this video and you want to show your support for the channel, there's a few ways you can do that. You can get yourself some LlamAcademy merch. This is actually my favorite shirt on the merch store. Check it out, see if you like something there, and that's a wonderful way to support the channel. You can use the affiliate links down in the description. Check out the Humble Bundle or Unity Asset Store there. Those give me a small percentage of the purchase price at no additional charge to you and helps me out a lot. You can also become a YouTube member or a Patreon supporter. Those two get you access to a member exclusive Discord server. At the phenomenal and the tremendous tier, you'll get this exclusive dissolve shader. Starting at the awesome tier, you'll get a shout out at the end of every video and your name appear on the screen, like Ivan, Ifiobolus, Perry, and Mustafa. And also at the supporter tier, you'll get your name at the end of every video and on every single GitHub repository that comes out while you're a supporter. Thank you all for your support. I am so incredibly grateful.